Can somebody please make note of this?
And then it goes, because it goes Bell, you know, the chair of the crime commission, who then is gonna, he has to, you know, front end prove sort of what they're gonna be able to take, he and the senator. So the best could go to him, not to us, and study, but the last file will go to him.
Okay, all right, thank you, I will take that under advisement for the next session.
I'll move it for PBI.
Okay, there's a motion and a second, PBI, the measure, please cast your vote. Measure fails to go forward by a vote of 4-1.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Let's see. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this is HJ number 8. This is concerning the Dulles Toll Road, or excuse me, the Dulles Greenway. And for those of you who are not from Northern Virginia, it's a 14-mile road that goes west from Route 28 to Leesburg. It's a 14-mile-long road. It was actually represents the first public-private partnership in Virginia. It's changed hands several times over the years. And this is a very high toll on it. You pay the same toll whether you use one exit or you go the whole 14 miles. The toll is over $6 right now, regardless of what time you take it. Many people in my district only use one or two exits, which is where most traffic is at. So the one exit is a quarter of a mile, they pay $6. The logical question would be, how about other alternatives? The other two roads that are offered, frankly, are heavily, they have a heavy traffic on them. And typically during the rush hour in the morning or evening, it's either pay $6 for a quarter mile or a mile, or spend 45 minutes to an hour in traffic. At the end of a work day, it basically means that many times people would be like picking up children from daycare, which could cost them a great deal of money. I'll make this very brief. There's been several studies on this before. I think those studies have been incorrect. They've studied a complete buyback. There's a series of bonds on this, and the debt is heavy. Half of the bonds are what are considered callable bonds. They can be bought back early with no penalty. The other half are non-callable bonds. If you buy them back now, you pay interest that would accrue between now and 2056, which would make them very expensive. The callable bonds have an average interest rate of 7.25%. The going rate for a AAA bond, a revenue bond, which would not be a debt on the Commonwealth, is about 4%. So there's an opportunity to save a great deal of money and possibly get relief to the people who were forced to take this road. The study VDOT has done this before, was only for a full buyback, not a partial buyback. And my bill would have VDOT go back and do a partial, look at a partial buyback and the benefits of the Commonwealth there. The data is present from VDOT on this, and I don't believe it would cost any money. It would just be a matter of looking at that data and recalculating it on a partial buyback. The Dulles area realtors support this. I've spoken with the owners of the Greenway, and I'm not going to say they support, but I know they're not opposed to it, and they would have good communication with it. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Any questions? Okay. Anyone here to speak to this measure?
Motion and second.
PBI.
Please cast your vote.
Mr. Chairman, I have 2 minutes on that.
I haven't called the vote yet.
Mr. Chairman, I don't want to waste your time. I'll just say that there are people who have to take this road every day, and again, they have no alternatives. It's very expensive, and all this bill does is try to study a way where we can try to find a path forward. It's not a path where we're going to be taking Commonwealth General Fund money towards it. It's just a pathway to try to provide some relief to people. And many before me, former Delegate May, Delegate Ramadan, we've tried to do this. This is a problem. And frankly, when people are paying this toll, it tolls to four or $400 or $500 a month, particularly those with two cars. So this is an issue, and I ask that you please give some deference to the people who are suffering on this situation now, and only allow VDOT to study this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, motion. Second. Equalize the bill. Please cast your vote. I vote 4-3. The measure is not followed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, thank you. Delegate Carr.
H.J. 73 in this year's legislative session because we continue to see instances of bullying and suicide among our youth, particularly in the LGBT community. This is not only occurring in Virginia, but nationally. The purpose of this resolution is to ensure that our Department of Education is providing our school systems with the most up-to-date and successful strategies for combating both bullying and suicide among our youth. We cannot tolerate needless loss of life for any particularly young people and those who are most vulnerable to bullying by their peers. If there is something that we as policymakers can do to change a law, a regulation, or a department directive to save even just one life, it will have been worth it. The resolution will give the Department of Education the chance to evaluate their current suicide prevention strategies and anti-bullying policies and identify areas for improvement that can be communicated to local school divisions. The second goal of the study is to determine the suicide rate for youth in Virginia and LGBT youth in Virginia so that the department can recommend policies to reduce these numbers, which we should consider one suicide one too many. I hope that you will look favorably upon this resolution to ensure that we're doing all that we can to ensure the safety of our youth and do whatever we can to prevent future tragedies from occurring here in our Commonwealth. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Anyone here to speak to this matter? Yes, sir. Delegate Lamas.
Another car. We just got a different paper. So I was trying to request school to do something. Did the department do this without a resolution? There's nobody from the department.
Is that Robinson?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. House Joint Resolution 19 continues the Joint Committee of the House Committee on Education and Senate Committee on Education and Health to continue studying the future of public elementary and secondary education in the Commonwealth. This committee, Joint Committee, has been meeting for the last two interims, 2016 and 2017. They've done a great deal of work, but their term expired in 2017. 2017. This resolution just asks that they be allowed to continue for another year with a maximum of 4 meetings. I think the fiscal impact is approximately $21,000 for this to happen. And as a member of that committee, I can just tell you that there's a lot of excellent work that's been done. There's a lot of things on the table that we need to wrap up. And I think you can get a lot of bang for the buck. I think it's been very worthwhile.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Doug, agree?
Can I make a motion to report?
Yes, sir.
Move to report.
Is this not this one?
I don't have a statement, Mr. Chairman.
Give me a thought.
The motion carries to lay the bill on the table 5-1.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will forego the 40-minute impassioned speech on the need for rural broadband, and I will simply say that HJ 106 would request the Broadband Advisory Council develop a system for rating communities where the most people can be served, increase broadband coverage for least cost. It is time, it's necessary, it's 2018, and I think we need a whole state plan to get these underserved, unserved areas covered. And the Center for Innovative Technology is here.
Questions? Yes, sir.
Isn't this what the council is supposed to be doing since we created it in 09?
Good question. Is there someone here to speak to this measure? Answer this question.
Well, I can.
Basic broadband, but we don't have broadband extending the last mile.
Magic. Thank you. Committee.
Chairman, I move PBI.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. PBI, any discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion of 4-2.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board.
4-3.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. For you, we have HJ 17, which would direct the SOL Innovation Committee to study experiential learning and workforce development opportunities for our high school students in high-demand fields. And as you all know, we are currently creating many high-tech paying jobs that require a skilled workforce. And I think we're in agreement here that those jobs should be filled by Virginians. And we teach our kids who, as early as at elementary school, certainly all the way up to college, that they can need to think outside of the box, and they need to find ways for the public and private sector to work together better, particularly as we're referring to STEM jobs. Whether we're talking about engineering, we're talking about agriculture, we're talking about computer coding, we want to move forward in the best way possible. I think we have an SOL Innovation Committee, and I think what we need to do really is figure out more ways to build linkages through these high school jobs and top high priority jobs at high school. And that's exactly what this bill does. Been working hard on this bill for quite a while. We have a lot of support. We have support from the chambers. We have actually, Mr. Chairman, your chamber, Hampton Roads Chamber, has supported this and endorses this bill. Northern Virginia Chamber, which is Delegate Plum. We've got Nova Chamber Partnership as well. Greater Richmond Chambers is in support. Roanoke Chamber, Delegate Habib. Greater Washington, Williamsburg Chamber, Fredericksburg Regional Chamber, VEA, AFD. I think we all recognize the direction we're heading in. We recognize an opportunity here when we see one, and I hope it'll be the will of this body to support and pass and report this resolution, HJ 17.
Delegate Landis.
Mr. Chairman, Delegate Phil Corns pointed out a very important issue. The problem is that's not what the SOL Innovation and Reform Committee was set up for. They are having a tough enough time just dealing with the high school redesign and how we're going to approach that. A lot of what you're actually asking to look for, they are going to be considering, because the last few years of high school is going to change dramatically. But we've also got to make sure we get the SOL testing correct, and that's got to be the first and foremost priority. So I think this is just a little bit premature based on the workload and the things they're going to do. Mr. Chairman, I'd also say that we've lost, at least from the House standpoint, a couple members that were there from the beginning. The Speaker's going to have to appoint some new members. They're going to have to get up to speed as well from the House perspective. So I think this is an important issue, and I don't want to diminish that. I agree with Delegate Phillip. I just think it's a little bit premature.
Mr. Chairman.
Hold on a second. Did you have a question? Okay, I'm sorry.
Would this be better, Delegate Landis, if a study like this went before the Joint Commission to Study the Future of Public Elementary and Secondary Education in Virginia? Would that make a difference? I mean, this is a very important topic, something that we're all dealing with every single day.
Delegate Phil Corns, yeah, Delegate Bell just had the resolution extend that for one more year. I like my idea better of having a mission that we're looking at more permanently, but the Speaker might just had a little bit difference of opinion on that. But I think their workload, at least for the next year, is pretty well finished up with things that they've already been doing. Now, if that body continues in the future, I think that is something we look at. But again, we would have to come back and have the general assembly consider that. I'm the chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I appreciate what the ladies brought to us. I think it's important that as we go forward, that we not look at how we built what we've been doing in the past, but how we look at things to be. For example, when I hear the testimony that we are saying that we're going to give our attention to the test, I think we missed the point. I think the reason the business community likes this kind of approach, it talks about experiential learning. We don't do much of that. The business community tells us all the time that that would be invaluable to people coming to the workforce, those who would have had some practical experiences rather than this school learning and rather than just trivial pursuit of SOL testing. So I think we really ought to take a look at this as a directional thing to whatever group we want to send it to, but make a statement that we're not just interested in how to shine up what we've been doing, but rather take a whole other look at how public education ought to be conducted, maybe at the high school level.
Yeah, I think this is one of those bills that probably every single person agrees with the problem and the goal, here what you're doing. I have a performance-based assessment bill this year to get the Board of Education to begin compiling performance-based assessments for localities or sort of best practices guide. That is a great way to assess the results of experiential learning. So this all goes hand in hand. A lot of these things are happening. The problem we have is the two commissions that study these, one that studies the assessment and the one that studies future of education, are both backed up on their workload. And so it isn't that we shouldn't continue to expand on both the teaching side and the assessment side. It's just that they can't take the workload this year.
Anyone here to speak to this measure?
Carries 4-3.
Mr. Chairman, just a moment speaking. And while the Chamber folks are here, I just want to say a big part of, I think, what's wrong with public education is the 140 of us down here. In that, over the years that I've been teaching and the time I've been in the General Assembly, I have seen that we have gone to a bifurcated diploma system where you're college bound or not. General diploma or college. And if you're college bound, right now today, Commonwealth of Virginia, the student is college bound. In their last 4 years, they've got two pre-elective periods. Ergo, the problem why we can't do the experiential learning, that until we as the legislature unwrap some of the mandates we put on public education, we know what the problem is. We don't have time in the kids' schedules for experiential learning. We don't have the courage to take away some of the academic mandates we put out there. So I just needed to say that. Thank you. I feel so much.
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman.
Something.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I feel a need to add just slightly to what Barack said. Not only do we get the burden down of all these courses, but in our studies, we start from the base that we don't have things the way they are and shine them up a little bit. We've got to sometimes shake this whole thing up and start anew. And this experiential learning thing is something that's going to happen to us. And we don't, it's we'd be smarter if we made that move now. Because the kids that we're trying to prepare for the workforce are going to work for 10 years from now. And so we lifted some of these requirements that allows some more innovation and less interruption. option on the part of the legislative mandates, I think you do a better job. I just had to say that.
Yes, sir. No, your Lance has to say something there.
Well, since we're part of this stuff, I said for years, since I've chaired the education committee, every member that either sits on that committee or doesn't sit on the committee is an expert on education. They all have somebody that they know is in public education. The problem with that is, it's just as Delegate Borak said and Delegate Plum has said, they all come up with good ideas. We've now made our schools social service agencies. We've mandated health requirements and all sorts of things to our teachers that don't accomplish any instructional purpose. Are important things, and I'm not trying to diminish those, but we've all been part of that. And I think if we can get Delegate Plum and Delegate Borak to agree to remind our members that we need to back off those things sometimes, we'd all be much better off. And we would have an opportunity to do what Delegate Philmore is trying to do. But unraveling that is the problem. And we need to stop adding and then look at unraveling.
Delegate Plum, do you have a measure?
I do. I have a House Joint Resolution 85. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, following the suggestion of Delegate Habib made earlier about how it is you get something to the Planning Commission, for the past several years I've been introducing bills to expand the definition of hate crime. And we've had the discussions in the Courts Committee year after year about what should constitute a hate crime and what the appropriate punishment should be and so on. I can't resolve that with the Courts Committee, but the Courts Committee guys could resolve it. And it would be my hope that we would be willing to send a study to the Virginia State Crime Commission, asking them to look at the prevalence. And we already know from data that's collected around that there's a high number of, there's an increasing number of hate crimes in the Commonwealth, as there are throughout our country, unfortunately. And we need to figure out, when should we take an incident and add to it a definition of being not just a crime, but it being a hate crime, and then with that, what would be the appropriate level of response in the judicial system? So that's pure and simply, it grows out of experience of, again, trying to do this through legislation, not being able to come to an agreement about it, but I'd like to see the legals of this place understand that this is a serious issue and take it on.
Does anyone care to speak to this measure? Okay. Clearly noted. Do you want to move your own? I'll ask for a motion.
So move to report.
Second. Okay. There's a motion and a second to report. Call for the question. Please cast your vote on the electronic voting card. By a vote of 3-4, the measure does not report. Doug Torian, do you have two measures, sir?
Yes, sir. I do. I have two. Mr. Chairman, I move to strike HJ 102.
Okay. There's a motion to strike House Joint Resolution 102. Docket. Please cast your vote. Okay. The motion to strike by 7-0 for docket. Yes, sir. Spell it for you.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. HJ 103 is a study of the Virginia retirement system, state-run retirement savings plan. And Mr. Chairman, just give the committee a little bit of history here. In 2016, HB 1998 Savings and Retirement Work Group completed their report. The work group recommended that a feasibility study be conducted on the issue of a state-run retirement savings plan for an individual without an employer-provided plan. HJ 103 is the result of an agreement between Christopher Newport support university and other private nonprofits. This study can be conducted with no physical impact on the Commonwealth. The resolution lays out the framework for the study and allows the stakeholders to examine the current retirement system. The study may also consider potential funding sources and determine which appropriate state agency that should administer a state-run retirement plan. Also, Mr. Chairman, I want to make a motion to move the substitute.
Second.
Hey, you show us.